Praise the Lord, everyone. All right, open your Bibles to the book of Isaiah. The book of Isaiah, chapter number 41. I have a few scriptures, and I will hit them as I go along, but I just want to start off here in the book of Isaiah. And verse 40, or chapter 41, verses 21 through 24. He says in verse 21, "Produce your cause, saith the Lord. Bring forth your strong reasons, saith the King of Jacob. Let them bring them forth and show us what shall happen. Let them show the former things, what they be, that we may consider them and know the latter end of them, or declare us things for to come. Show the things that are to come hereafter, that we may know that ye are gods. Yea, do good or do evil, that we may be dismayed and behold it together. Behold, ye are of nothing, and your work of naught. An abomination is he that chooseth you." And we'll stop there. And I just would like to speak this morning from the subject of your cause and your strong reason. Your cause and strong reason. I chose that because I like the way God deals with his people. He's not a tyrant. He's not a bully. He doesn't beat us up and make us do. But one of the things that God does is he talks to his people. Sometimes we don't understand when God is talking to us because we have a lot of chatter going on in our brain. We have a lot of things happening, and so we don't really hear him. I know there is a passage in the Bible that talks about Moses, and God is being extremely clear. He said, "To Moses I speak face to face, as a man speaks to his friends. But to everybody else, I speak to them in dark sayings and in dreams." So God is not always clear when he's talking to us. There are times when God is very clear, but a lot of times we're not sure if it's God talking to me or not. And saints will come to me and ask me, they'll present their situation and say, "But I feel like the Lord is telling me," and they will tell me what they feel like God has said and say, "But is that the Lord?" Because we don't always understand the voice of the Lord when he's talking to us. And one thing that you can say for sure, that when God does talk to us, it never contradicts his word. God never tells us to do something different than what the Bible already tells us to do. So if he said, "Thou shalt not lie," God's not going to go tell you to lie to somebody. He doesn't make special privileges just for his people. God holds his own self to rules. There's things that God said that he just will not violate. One of them is that all liars and unbelievers shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire. He's not going to change that for anybody. You may love God and you may think that God loves you, but there's a whole lot of folks. The Bible says it like this, "And many shall say in that day, Lord, Lord." See, they believe they have a relationship with God. They think they're doing what God wants, but his response will be, "Depart from me, ye that work iniquity, for I never knew you." So that's the reason why I said you may think God loves you too, but if you're not obedient, forget the songs, forget the cliches that talk about God's unconditional love. That's nowhere in the Bible. Somebody made that up to justify themselves, to make them feel better about their wrongdoing. But nowhere in the Bible does it say God's love is unconditional. Matter of fact, it says just the opposite of that. When Esau and Jacob was in their mother's womb, he said, Jacob have I loved, but Esau have I hated. Now, you can't say God's love is unconditional and he hates somebody. And so the thing I love about God in his word is God listens to his people. He talks to his people. He speaks to those that love him and those that are willing to abide by what he has set up. God does that. And here he's dealing with the children of Judah. Isaiah has gone to them and he's prophesying to them. He's trying to get them to understand that their gods mean nothing. And he has six challenges God gives to these false gods. And one of them is to produce your cause. And by cause, he means your quarrel. What is your argument with against me? There are times when people start off saying they love God, and then something happens bad. They lose a child, or they lose their car, or they get fired from their job, and all of a sudden they don't love God so much anymore. And so that's their quarrel. That's their argument against God. I know people that have walked away from God for some very petty things. He said, what's your quarrel with me? What can you say that I've done? Matter of fact, what can you say that you have done? And that's why he says, produce your cause and bring forth your strong reasons. Talk with me and help me to understand why I should listen to you. David said it like this. If you got a quarrel with God, David said it like this. I've never seen the righteous forsaken. Never seen his seed begging bread. God always treats his people right. God always treats his people fairly. God is never just mean for the sake of being mean, but everything he does is for a good reason. God has a cause. I know that they've written books about us living in our purpose, but we only have one purpose, and that is to serve God's purpose. We only have one cause, and that is God. The apostle said it like this, I know only one thing, that's Jesus Christ and him crucified. That's all I know. And that should be our mindset often when we find ourselves with our back against the wall. I can't answer anything. All I know is Jesus Christ and him crucified. I know that he died for me. I know that he rose again, and I know he put his spirit down in me. I know that all things work together for the good, for them that are the called and those that are called according to his purpose. Those that are doing what God wants, everything works for our good. Even though we don't see it that way, it is. I might get a flat tire and I don't see it as for my good, but it might be for my good. No, it is for my good as long as I'm doing what God wants me to do. Man, I might get an eviction notice about my house and not know what's going to happen, but as long as I'm living like I'm supposed to live, as long as I'm loving God like I'm supposed to love him, I can be assured that all things are working together for my good. I might not understand where God is taking me, but I know he's not leading me anywhere wrong. He tells them, for those that are serving the false gods, he said, then let them bring forth their proof. Let them prove to me what they're doing. Let them show the things that are to come. One of the things that God used here as evidence of the difference between a false god and a real god was the fact that a false god can make predictions, but they don't come true. But a true God can say those things that be not as though they are. He can call those things that haven't happened and say it as if it already has happened. Only God can do that. And so he tells them, let them bring forth their proof. Show former predictions that have come true. Show me something that you have said was going to happen and it happened. And he's not talking about foolishness. If you get up every day, you can say, today I'm going to eat. That's not a prediction. Now, and we're not going to read it, but if you get down to verse 25, the Lord proves it. He tells them, I call forth things. I say things. As a matter of fact, he's talking about here Cyrus, 200 years before Cyrus became anything, before he was born. 200 years before the man was alive, the Lord said what he was going to do. I'm going to set him up and establish him. He's going to let my people rebuild their temple. He's going to be my prince. God established that. God said that 200 years before it happened. He said, now, for those of you that have your gods that you believe in, go get your zodiacs. Go get your paper and bring it out and show me what your gods have said that has come true. I prophesied 200 years before the man was born, and it came true. 600 years before Jesus, I prophesied that a woman should compass a man, that I would bring forth a child, that his name would be Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God. He predicted that long before Jesus got here. And today we can go back, and if somebody said, prove to me that God said something and it came true, we can go back in the Old Testament and we can dig up all the things that God said would happen that have happened. There are things that God has said would happen in the New Testament. They happen in today. We're living in perilous times. We're living in the last days where there's famines and earthquakes in diverse places, wars and rumors of wars. All of this is taking place. God predicted that 2,000 years ago. He said this was going to happen. And what's happening? Exactly what God said was going to happen. It's happening. So he's challenging them. He said, tell them to show me where they predicted something would happen and it came to pass. I can show you in the Bible where they said it wouldn't happen, but it did. I know when Pharaoh said, who is this God that I should obey him? But when it was all said and done, he said, get out of Egypt. Exactly what God said he wanted to happen. It happened. There's others who have dared to challenge God. There's others who thought to raise their hand against God, and he strike them down. Amen. Thank God for his mercy today. Thank God for his grace today. There's some folks, I know a man right now, he's still alive. And he said, if God is real, let him come down and face me like a man. Do you think God did it? No, but one day, he gonna get to face him. One day that's gonna happen. But thank God that he's got grace, because sometimes in our ignorance, sometimes in our foolishness, we challenge God. Sometimes in our hurt or our anger, we'll challenge and threaten and make all kind of crazy statements about God. And if God did in the New Testament like he did in the Old Testament, some of us wouldn't be here right now. But thank God for his mercy. And the times when we speak foolishly against God, when God challenged Job, he said, who could answer him 1,000? Out of 1,000 questions, who could answer one of them that God asked? He could question you all day long, and all you could do is just guess, and you would never get any of it right. Thank God that he's got the mercy to understand we speak foolish sometimes. All right, I'm going to leave that alone. I don't know who I'm preaching to. Finally, he gets to the point to where he said, if you are a God, then do something good or do something evil. What do you think you can do? What can God do that's made out of paper? What can God do that's made out of wood? What can God do that's made out of gold or silver or rocks? He said, do something good then if you're a God. Do something evil. Show me something. Don't just sit on the table. Don't just sit at the altar. Get up and do something. Show me something. Now, I know that this sounds a little old-fashioned, but we got people today doing the same thing. They put their trust in the newspaper. They put their confidence in the zodiacs. They like to go to the Chinese restaurant and get the fortune cookie and open it up. And let's see if that's going to come true. It's just a piece of paper. It's got numbers on the back of it. Sometimes folk play the numbers from the back. Just foolishness. That God can't help you. When you are laying in your bed sick, you can't pray to the fortune cookie and it do something for you. When your child is in trouble, when you're struggling with problems on your job, you can't pray to the newspaper and it help you. You can't pray to a rock and it do something for you. Gold, you may have a god of gold, and the only thing you can do with that is sell it and get some money, but it can't do anything for you. Man, in one place in the Bible, he talks about the fact that we have a God with ears that can hear when his people cry to him, eyes that can see the problems that his people are going through, hands that he can use to deliver his people from their troubles. What other God is like that God? And then we get bold and we get beside ourselves and we want to challenge him. And in Isaiah chapter 1 and verse 18, he said, "Come now, let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool." One of the things that God is doing here, he challenged the other gods. If you're real, then reason with me. Then he turns around to his people and he says, "Now come and let us reason together." We have a God that we can reason with. It's not the kind of reasoning where you can bargain with God and get something from him, but God can show you things. You may be at a point in your life where you don't understand something going on. "I know I've been faithful. I know I've done everything I was supposed to do. I know when the boss told me to pick up the papers, I picked them up. I know when they told me to take out the trash, I took it out. And now I'm the first one on the chopping block. I don't understand." But the Lord said, "Come, let us reason together." You can talk to God and he knows how to comfort. You can speak to him and he knows how to give understanding where there was no understanding. We can sit down and have a conversation with our God and he will talk back to his people. The enemy would have us to believe that there are times in our life when we have done things so bad that God would never forgive you. He said, "But though your sins be as scarlet, I'll make them white as snow. I can clean you up. I don't care how bad your life has been. I don't care the kind of sin you've lived in. I don't care the kind of things that you have thought and said. It doesn't matter." He said, "Let's sit down and reason about this thing. Even though you cut up, even though you clown, you may have been joking. I'm not going to get saved because all my friends is going to hell. And I'm going to hell with them. We're going to have a party there in hell." He said, you may talk silly like that, but let's sit down and reason this thing out together. Let's talk about this because you don't understand what you're saying. You don't understand how foolish you are in the things that you are saying. You may have challenged me, but though your sins were as scarlet, I can make them white as snow. Your friends can make you feel better, but they can't take your sins away from you. Your confidant might be able to cry with you and make you feel like you've been heard, but they can't take your sins away from you. Nobody can take your sins. You can go and buy all the self-help books you want at the bookstore. You can go broke buying books and spend all your time reading them, and it still can't take away your sins. There's only one thing that can take away your sins, and he talks about it here in Isaiah. He said, "Come and let us reason together. I am the God that can take your sins, and though they are white, red as crimson, I can make them white as snow. I can take anything. No matter how bad it is, I can take it and wipe it away." This is not a man that's hurt that's approaching God. This is a God that's hurt that's approaching man. God that said, "Look at what I've done for you, and what have you done for me? I know what I've done to help you. You got up this morning. You walked this morning. You spoke this morning. You ate this morning. You drank this morning. I know what I've done for you. I gave you a mind to be in church this morning. I know what I've done for you. What have you done for me?" This is God looking out for people. I know a lot of times we like to think that, I hear folks say it often, I found Jesus. You didn't find him. He wasn't lost. We're the ones that were lost. We're the ones that needed help. We're the ones that God came looking for me. If you get saved, it's because God come looking for you. God came down in the midst of all of your mess, in the midst of all of your sin, all of your transgressions, all of your high-mindedness and your vulgarity. God came in the midst of all of that and said, come with me. Come to me. And thank God we had a mind to follow the call of God when he called us out of all of that. Sometimes folk like to wallow in all that sin. But he said, come, let us reason together. I know what you've been doing. I know what you've been thinking. You might walk around with a great reputation, but I know what you've been thinking. And I know your thoughts haven't been clean thoughts. I know your thoughts have not been pure thoughts. A lot of times we get the idea that what I do is God's business. What I think is my business. No. With God, he said, what you do is my business. What you think is my business. And if you don't believe it, he said, I know you've heard it said of old that a man should not commit adultery. But I say, if you think, God cares about what we think too. He said, now look, you might got your act together. You might be walking around in the street and everybody thinks that you're a good person. He said, but don't you worry. I know what you've been thinking. And though your thoughts have been filthy, I can make them clean. Though your thoughts have been against me, I can turn your heart around and make you love me. I can help you to see who I am and what I've done for you. I can turn your life around completely and make you a new creature. In the book of Joshua chapter 24 and verse 14 and 15, he says this, now therefore fear the Lord. And here he doesn't mean to be scared. He's talking about having respect. Now therefore fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in truth. Don't come to church just because that's what you're supposed to do. Be sincere in your walk with God. Don't come to church and you hypocritin'. You in the church right now listening to the preacher, but all you thinking about is getting home so you can get to your pornography. He said, in sincerity and in truth, put away the gods which your father served on the other side of the flood and in Egypt and serve you the Lord. And everybody got some family gods. Everybody got somebody that our father served. Some of us serve family. We come up with the notion that family is more important than anything. Blood's thicker than water. I mean, okay. You can have that attitude if you want to. Some folks believe family comes first. Don't you? No matter what happens, family comes first. Let the preacher say something that offends somebody in my family and we don't go to church there no more. You're serving the wrong God. Because all souls belong to God. Man, I love my children, but when they wrong, they wrong. I love my mother, but if she's wrong, she's wrong. I love my dad, but if he's wrong, he's wrong. My uncles and my aunts, if they wrong, they wrong. That's all. Put away those gods. Put away those things. We call them today, we call them traditions. This is just a family tradition. Put all that foolishness away. If it gets in the way of God, put it away. And if it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord, choose you this day who you will serve. Look at how fair God is. If you think I'm evil, then don't serve me. If you think I'm good, then serve me. But choose today who you're going to serve. Whether the gods of your fathers, which your fathers served, that were on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land ye dwell, but as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. God gives us a choice. God gives us a choice whether we want to serve him or not. And let me just be clear about this, because I know sometimes it feels like it's hard being saved. It is hard to be saved. But the way of a transgressor is really hard. You think it's hard being saved? Live as a backslider. It's hard being a sinner. It's hard being a saint. But a backslider got it harder than everybody else. Man, the world, they don't quite fit in the world no more, because they know too much. They don't fit back in the church because they're doing too wrong. They just don't fit in nowhere, and they can't find rest anywhere. All right. God gives us a choice. We can choose to serve God, or we can choose to produce our cause and bring to God our strong reasoning why my God is better than him. But the bottom line for me, as for me and this house, we gonna serve the Lord. You might have your cause. You might have your strong reasoning. And one day you might have an opportunity to give it to God and let him know why your gods was better than him. But I would ask you, just like he said here in Isaiah, let your God speak up then. Let your God do something. Let him do some good or some evil. Let him predict something that's going to come to pass. Tell me something that's going to happen next year. Tell me when the rapture is going to take place. If your God is that good, let him do something. Amen? All right. Elder Pompey, come and give our altar call.